PlayStation 5 is full of surprises, stuff that you probably had no idea about. Hi folks, it's Falcon, and today on GameRanks, 10 PS5 hacks and tricks you probably didn't know. Starting off at number 10, there is actually a web browser. And there is an actual web browser on the PS4, and while it's not the best, it works. So I don't really know why Sony's keeping this basic feature a secret on the PlayStation 5, but if you want to use it, it's there. Just takes a little effort. Two main ways to access the web, either through messages or through Twitter. Twitter options are a little bit easier. All you have to do for this is go to the settings menu, select users and accounts, click link with other services. Yeah, don't worry, it'll make sense in a second. Open up Twitter. Now open up the Twitter option and the hidden web browser app will open into a sign-in page. You can't change the URL, but you can click this sign up for Twitter option. Now you just hit the X, you get rid of the pop-up, and you're free to browse Twitter as much as you want. It's not a perfect solution because, like I said, you can't change the URL, but if you use Twitter search, you should be able to find a link to basically anything. The other option, through messages, may be easier for you depending on if your friends don't mind sending them a bunch of garbage messages. The trick is to send a message to a friend containing a URL. If it actually links to something, you can access the chat and just click on the link. It'll get you pretty much anywhere, but it's like beyond tedious to use, and your friends will probably start to resent you for sending them URLs. I do want to give credit to Reddit user Diashito for discovering this trick. It's pretty clever, even if the web browser really isn't great. Like, it's fairly limited, seriously. You can't even make it full screen. But it does work on most web pages, including YouTube, so it's not totally useless. Eventually, Sony's probably going to patch in a proper browser, but who knows how long. Until they do, this is probably the best option. And number 9, console sharing and offline play is actually better than you think. One of those functions that I'm sure a lot of people are aware of, but don't really grasp how powerful it can actually be. Being able to share console accounts on multiple machines was possible on the PlayStation 4, but this whole feature is a lot more powerful on the PS5, and you'll soon see exactly what I mean by that. Setting it up is simple, as long as you got a friend who can either sign in or doesn't mind sharing their username and password. That's the biggest hurdle, and if you got somebody you can trust in that way, you should really try console sharing. Once you have the second account added, you just open it up and you have access to their entire library of games. The reverse is true as well. They have access to your entire library. For digital only games, that means you can download and play anything off of your friend's account, even if you don't own it, which is awesome. But what makes the sharing particularly impressive is you don't even need to be signed into your friend's account to play their games. That means if a friend shares their copy of God of War Ragnarok with you, you can download and play it in your own account. That means you don't have to worry about sharing saves or interrupting your friend's game time. Basically, you have a free game. You can even access the PlayStation Plus and premium catalogs as long as your friend has a subscription. As long as at least one person on a shared account has it, both people have it. There is one import setting you'll need to make all this possible, though. You go to user and account settings, scroll down to other, and look for console sharing and offline play, and make sure it's enabled. If it is, you can play your friend's games even offline, so even if your internet goes out, you'll still be able to play. It does require weekly checkup on the digital games, and for most people, that should be more than enough. Console sharing is one of those features that I think sounds too good to be true for a lot of people, but it actually is amazing. And number 8, there is a really handy search shortcut. Simple, but very, very useful. It's part of the UI. When you're on the main screen, you press the triangle button at any time. You'll immediately move to the upper right corner options, search, setting, and profiles. When you're first setting up the PS5, this can be really handy because you're going to be digging through the options a lot when you're just getting started. But I get a lot of use out of the instant search bar, honestly. I try to play games on PC, but that doesn't mean I don't have a lot of games on the PS5. So I'm pretty much always using this to find certain games, and being able to go straight to that option with just the press of a button is super handy. Like, it's not essential, but it really helps, and it's also really easy to overlook. While we're talking about shortcuts, if you're opening up the media tab often, there's an easier way to get to that as well. Just hit R1 to switch to media and L1 to switch back to games. Yes, you can just press up and select the tab that you want, but this is faster, like quite a bit faster, even though it's only one button click versus three. And number 7, did you know you can finally sort your games into folders? Now, this has been a long requested feature because the PS4 had them and the PS5 hasn't. Now, they do work differently than on the PS4. The only way to find them is to go to game library, press up, scroll over to your collection, and that's where you can create folders. From there, you look for the icon under sort and filter with the little folder with the plus on it, and you click create game list. After hitting that, you can scroll through your games and add up to 100 titles to a list, give it a name, good to go. You can make up to 15 of these, and you're free to organize them however you want, so you can put multiple games into multiple folders. It's not the best implementation, but at least it's there. It lets people at least have a slightly more orderly version of what can be a sprawling mess of games. Moving on to number 6, you can change the icons in the control center. The PS5 control center is pretty handy for quickly turning off the console or accessing some other stuff while you're in-game, but the icon placement can start to get a little annoying after a while. I don't know about you, but having to scroll over to access the power and controller settings isn't my favorite thing. There's actually a way to reorganize it, though, at least. Just open up the control center, highlight an icon, and hit the options button. This opens up a new menu where it can change the order of tabs or hide them completely, and if you screw it up, you can always reset things back to default. This is another one of those small convenience things that it's not the most important thing ever, but if you use your PlayStation 5 a lot, being able to optimize and control, you know, these settings on somewhat of a custom level can make navigating the console just a little less annoying. Coming in at number 5, reusing your PS4's internal storage. You probably already know about how to use external storage on the PS5. If you plug in an external solid state or standard storage device, you can extend the pretty meager storage capacity of the console. That alone isn't something you didn't know. Everybody knows that. But there's a pretty clever thing you can do to get some use out of your old internal PS4 drive. All you need to do is buy a USB 3.0 hard drive case, remove the internal PS4 storage, which is not hard, even I can do it, feathers and all, and then plug it into the hard drive case. There, you turned your old PS4 internal drive into an external PS5 drive, which will at minimum double the amount of possible storage on the console. It's just a clever way to save some money, especially if you're not planning on going back to the old PS4 anyway. These USB enclosures are crazy cheap too. They go for around $5 on Newegg, so if you're feeling the burn on your wallet but need some additional storage for the console, this is a really cheap and easy option. At number 4, similarly, you can mute all audio on the PS5. Now, for players who live in a crowded house or just mute their TV a lot because, I don't know, maybe they've got a really annoying neighbor with supersonic hearing, who knows? I've seen it before, I've lived in apartments. But this is a really handy little option on the DualSense controller I did not even realize was there. At this point, a lot of people know that if you press the lit up mic button under the PlayStation button, you'll mute the microphone, but you can turn off all the sound coming from the PS5 by just holding that button down for a second. You don't press it, you hold it, and that shuts off everything. Compared to, you know, finding the TV remote, that is a tremendously appealing option. To be frank, I did not even find that thing to turn the TV on. I've got all the HDMI activated, turn the system on thing on. And it's been like that for a very long time, so this is better. Now, it's not something everybody's gonna use, but for the people who use it, I think it's probably gonna be a pretty useful little shortcut. At number 3, I bet you didn't know this, PS5 games can be played on ultra-wide monitors. Now, I had no idea this was possible. It actually goes into ultra-wide resolution. Now, this wasn't always the case, to be frank, until September 2022 when the big update was added in. I mean, you got a lot of stuff like 2K resolution support. For whatever reason, before this update, however, the only resolutions you could output were 720p, 1080p, and 2160p. And with this update, they added 1440p, which makes it possible to display on an ultra-wide monitor. Now, according to this pretty thorough article, when you connect an ultra-wide monitor to the screen, the 2560 by 1440 image is upscaled to 3440 by 1440 without really a lot of ugly scaling or stretching, to be clear. Getting the best possible image when connected to an ultra-wide monitor still takes a little effort, but it really depends on the kind of ultra-wide you've got. At least for now, if you want to get a wider image playing PS5 games, you can, though. Before, you'd either get big black bars on the screen or the screen would get all stretched out, but now they've given the system proper 2K resolution options, and it actually makes the system play nice with most extra-wide monitors. And number 2, the PS5 has a safe mode. Even after a number of updates, the PlayStation 5 continues to be just maybe a little unstable, I guess is the best way to put it. One way to fix some of the more common issues is to clear the cache, which in certain situations can fix issues like freezing, the internet disconnecting randomly, and sometimes really long load times, which is very strange on the PS5, which is designed not to have. To do this, you want to access safe mode, which among many other things, has an option that lets you clear the cache at will. This isn't something you should be doing regularly, but if your PS5 is experiencing some issues, it's not a bad place to start. To access safe mode, you got to turn off everything completely. completely. You then press and hold the power button for 5 to 10 seconds until you hear the beep a second time. Now you release it and the console boots into safe mode, where you get a few options on how to proceed. If you want to clear the cache, you just scroll down and select that option and you should be good to go. Another way to clear the cache is simply turn the console off, then unplug the power cord from the back of the console for about 1 to 3 minutes. Once you plug it back in, the cache is cleared, totally bypasses safe mode. Simpler option, but if you'd rather know for sure the cache is clear, start with the normal safe mode setup. All this is basically just troubleshooting, but most of the time, if you're going to deal with customer support, they're going to tell you to do this. But if you know how to do it ahead of time, you don't have to wait on the phone for them to tell you to do it. I mean, your hold time is probably going to be longer than this whole video, right? So, you're welcome. And finally, at number one, there is a hidden debug menu. Other than the web browser at the top of the list, not a lot of hidden features on the PS5. If you really want a menu that Sony doesn't want you to access, though, take a look at this. As reported by the hacking website, wololo.net, nice Age of Empires 2 reference there, it's actually possible to access a debug menu on the PS5 by pressing Start and L3 while debug settings are enabled. How do you enable debug settings? Well, you need to hack the PS5 to do that. So for most people, this menu is not going to become accessible just because you know the button combination, you know? If you're somehow watching this video and you do have a hacked PS5, what are you doing here though? You know all this stuff already. The debug menu itself is pretty bare bones. Think Sony probably removed a lot of debug features for the retail menu. If you try to use the option there, it's not going to do a lot. So while the menu's literally hidden, there's not really a lot to get excited about either. For hackers, it's probably noteworthy, and it may lead to further opportunities to break the system, but for you and me, it's a menu that doesn't do anything that we can't even get to. Not exactly the most impressive feature, but I did not know it was there. And that's all for today. Leave us a comment. Let us know what you think. If you like this video, click like. If you're not subscribed, now's a great time to do so. We upload brand new videos every day of the week. Best way to see them first is, of course, a subscription. So click subscribe. Don't forget to enable all notifications. And as always, we thank you very much for watching this video. I'm Falcon. You can follow me on Twitter @FalconTheHero. And we'll see you next time right here on GameRanks.